I'm standing outside a Hollywood landmark. Now it's Herb Alpert's A&M Records. But 50 years ago, it was the Charlie Chaplin Studios. Silent movies were created here then. Now the nation's leading sounds are produced here, today's hit records. Our about-to-be-surprised guest comes from the very top of the musical world. The truth is, two people will be surprised when they hear the words, "This is your life." I'll meet you inside. Come along.
This is your life, an American tradition with Ralph Edwards.
Karen? Oh, it's a pretty dress.
Thank you.
How are you?
Just fine, thanks.
Yeah. You know what we're doing? We're doing a... It's a documentary show for, you know, A&M. Uh-huh. And Jerry will be here in a bit. We're doing it with all the artists, and it's going to be for, promotion and possibly, you know, for movies or something like that. It's possible, I don't know.
Herb Alpert, documentary, scene 26, take one.
So we'll listen to...
Hello, Herb, Karen, and Richard. I'm sorry to interrupt this great music of yours, but I have an important announcement for two people in this studio. It's so important that I'll say it in person. Hi, everybody. My name's Ralph Edwards, and I'm here to surprise one of the hottest teams in musical history, you might say. There are three gold records for We've Only Just Begun and Close to You, and an album are examples of the talent involved here. Well, I don't think we can delay it any longer. Richard and Karen Carpenter, this is your life.
What?
Herb, thank you very much.
Herb Alpert, helping us like this is something we'll never be able to repay. Did it cross your mind at all that it might be your life?
We were blanched a little, you know, when I came out there. You're a giant in this business, and we'll find out the major part you played in the lives of Carpenters when we arrive at... What's that?
We're too young for this.
Oh, you say that in your songs all the time. Are you kidding? Now, do you know the show at all?
I watched Red Nichols when he was on it.
Few years ago. Don't get out of hand here now, Richard boy. Are you ready to go?
Yeah.
You don't know where you're going?
No, I don't know where
we're going. Back to our This Is Your Life theater, and lots of things are going to happen back there. As your hit tune is saying, we've only just begun. Thank you again, Herb Alpert. Come on here, gang. Let's get going. A kiss for luck and we're
on. And now, here are Ralph Edwards and tonight's surprise guests, Karen and Richard Carpenter.
A little bit different than Aberdeen, South Dakota, huh, Karen?
I'm gonna fall asleep for this one.
Now wait a minute, who are these guys anyhow?
I don't know.
Well, one is Doug Strawn. Hello, Doug.
Right, hi,
and
there.
One is Gary Sims.
That's
I think
Gary.
These are two members of your group. Is
yes,
that right?
Exactly.
What is all this Aberdeen stuff?
Well, we because we all like to drive.
All of you are. Yeah, just
well, Richard enjoys it the most. He's a car freak. You see, it's
a strange thing.
No,
a car freak.
And we drove from Murray, Kentucky, to if you remember, to Aberdeen, South Dakota, 29 hours. We had to do a concert in Aberdeen. And we fell asleep practically during the show.
It was what, Gary?
A disaster
show. Well, let's forget about it now because it's all behind us, you know. Let's go up to the stage and talk about your successes. Thank you very much, Doug and Gary. Come on up and see us. How do you feel about all this, anyhow?
Oh, it's great.
Well, sit back here now and relax, Richard and Karen. Did you ever think anything like this would happen to you?
No, absolutely not.
So we've only just begun, and the great new American phenomenon has happened. Young people, within almost minutes of time, earning success. In this instance, with real talent, Karen singing and drumming, and Richard composing, singing and playing several instruments. Let's go back to the beginning, which was not too long ago.
Uh-oh.
New Haven, Connecticut, 1 year after the end of World War II. Now, this house is where you, Richard, were born on October 15th, 1946. Does it look familiar?
Oh, yeah.
Which window was yours? Oh, it's gone now. Karen comes along 3.5 years later, March 2nd, 1950. Karen finds her talent as a musical performer, toe dancing, while Richard spends endless hours listening to records. Now, how old were you when the piano came into the Carpenter house, Richard?
The first time it came in, I guess I was around 8 or 9.
What do you mean? It was repossessed and sent in again?
Oh, no, I didn't. My cousin wanted to take a piano, and they got a real good one.
And then after 3 years of lessons, everyone knows the combination of Richard and the piano has only just begun.
I recommended you to Yale University Music School when you were 15 years old. You were accepted and studied classical music.
And who subjected you to endless hours of piano practice? From New Haven, Connecticut, your former music teacher, Hank Will. Hank, did you ever think your student, Richard Carpenter, would earn 3 gold records?
No, certainly not.
Thanks.
No, really, Ralph, I was very well aware of Richard's talent.
Yes.
And in fact, after a year of taking lessons with him, I told his parents that he was well beyond me.
It's because he couldn't stand me.
Richard has his own interpretation of music, and this uniqueness is what made him what he is today.
And in a way, Richard and Karen, you played Cupid. Hank married your cousin, Joan, who's sitting in our audience right out there.
One word, Hank.
What's yeah, that? Thank you, Hank. Yeah. Thank you. Now, Richard, while you were inside playing piano, Karen, you were outside playing baseball, right?
Yeah.
What position did you play?
I like to pitch.
I understand you did there with the neighborhood team. They were all guys, and you played. And for both of you, your spiritual life has always been an important part of your beings.
I was 28 when Richard and Karen were part of our congregation in New Haven.
Now, chaplain at Southwestern University, Georgetown, Texas.
Charlie?
You haven't seen him or his lovely wife for 7 years, Reverend and Mrs. Charles Neal. Come on over and sit down here, Mrs. Neal. Mr. Neal, you and the carpenter shared a deep appreciation for music, I understand. Is that right?
Yes, I spent many hours listening to records and in the carpenter's home, and Richard and I were always working together with the sound system. And My Fair Lady.
Right.
Yeah. Wow.
Richard and Karen were also very active in our Methodist Youth Fellowship there, which Charles and I sponsored.
Yeah, I remember that.
And I must mention, in reference to Richard's musical talent, he has a talent for losing things. Do you remember what I'm talking about, Richard?
He never lost anything, did he, Reverend Neal?
Losing?
Do you remember the time that you were to play the organ for church and lost the organ key? And
oh, yes.
Well, you finally found it and turned the organ on, and it's great to know that you've been turning the musical world on ever since.
Well, thank you, wow. Reverend and Mrs. Neal, for providing the Carpenters with the, well, two powerful ways of expression, friendship and faith.
Wow.
Thank you.
In 1963, you moved west to Downey, California, in the Los Angeles area. Your lives went on, as did your music. You, Karen, had settled back to drumming tabletops, keeping time to Richard's music.
She sat back just long enough to stand up and march.
One of your favorite teachers at Downey High School, Bruce Gifford. Glockenspiel to tenor drum. How did Karen start playing these instruments, Mr. Gifford?
Well, to be honest with you, it started because she was trying to escape physical education.
I thought you were a baseball player.
They don't let you play baseball.
Oh,
they
I
just
see.
Made
okay.
You run a
All
lot.
Right.
Well, I gave her a drumstick, and she hasn't gotten rid of it since. Before Karen and Rich actually created Carpenters, Rich played piano with a group I have that performs around town. You?
Yeah, Sierra Room.
Anyway, I experienced then the great talent that the world is just now beginning to hear.
Well, thank you very much. Bruce Gifford.
Yeah.
I first met Richard at a Sunday afternoon concert in Furman Park. When I heard him at the piano, I knew he was just what the church needed.
Former choir director at Downey Methodist Church, Vance Hayes.
Well, after hearing Richard play in the park that Sunday, I asked him to be our church organist.
Well, what was your response to that, Richard?
I did not play the pedals of the organ. Only the keys, you know.
Well, we had him there as the organist just the same. And the preludes, the offertories, the postludes, and the incidental organ music were all Richard's born at the moment. And the church never heard such beautiful music. I must admit, though, every once in a while, I would hear a Beatle tune come out of the organ all dressed up in Richard's Sunday best.
Well, you know, maybe the good Lord was enjoying the magnificent deception along with you, Richard. Thank you very much, Vance Hayes. The Carpenters were introduced to a receptive public. The event was the Los Angeles Battle of the Bands.
Oh.
You want to tell us how you came out on that?
Pretty good.
Matter of fact, you won, didn't
yeah,
you? At the
yeah.
Hollywood Bowl over there. Right. You were called the Carpenter Trio then.
Right,
who was the third member?
Oh, not James. Is he here?
He played the tuba and bass, didn't he? Wes is now with the Detroit Symphony.
Right. I have come here to inform the public about the Carpenter Curse.
Here from Detroit, Michigan is Wes Jacobs. Carpenter curse.
Well,
Wes Jacobs.
No. You were supposed to
go
say
ahead, tell
the carpenter. The Carpenter curse really is their bad luck, especially his.
Yeah.
One time, well, I should say when we played for the Battle of the Bands at the Hollywood Bowl, Richard rehearsed on a grand piano, but when it came time to actually do the concert, they had a bad upright piano on stage for him to play.
He still won the contest. It seems that the Carpenter Curse may start out bad, but end up great.
Well, that's right, Ralph. I remember one night we were rehearsing really strong over at the Carpenter place. So strong that a neighbor called the police on us.
Oh, brother. Yes.
Well, when the policemen got there, they came in and really enjoyed what the neighbor had been complaining about. Of course, well, we toned it down a little bit.
Well, of course.
We turned it off before he got
there. Right. But anyway, the policemen stayed for about a half an hour just to listen to the music, and they had a cup of coffee
with
us.
It's hard to resist the Carpenter's music, especially the LAPD, you know. And we'll return with more surprises from the Carpenter Curse. After Wes Jacobs joined the Detroit Symphony, you, Richard, started a new group called The Spectrum, with Karen added as the group's novelty, a girl drummer, not a baseball player this time. After winning the grand prize of $2,500 on the All-American College Show, The Spectrum played club dates at the Troubadour, Whiskey A Go-Go, and other clubs.
The night I heard your tape, the destiny of all of our lives was changed.
The man who heard your recording and then introduced you to the world, Mr. Jack Doherty. Well, Jack, sit down and tell us all about
right.
it. How did this all get going?
Well, I don't know. It seemed like I heard a tape that they'd made, and we couldn't find anybody that would record us because the sound was too soft, a sound in a hard rock business. And so I don't know. It seemed like no time at all. We were selling number one all over the world, so.
Yeah, they received five out of seven record industry awards for music in 1970.
Including a very valuable award as a trendsetter, which we highly esteem.
A trendsetter, you
trendsetter.
Bet. Now, this all began where, would you say?
Well, the part that I heard began back in, there's a fabulous bass player in this town named Joe Osborne, and he had a garage studio, and they started making tapes with Joe, and with his help, the tape that I heard, we came from Joe's garage that Karen Richard had made with Joe's help, and we tried to get started, but we were having a little difficulty until we ran into
a fellow
who was on... A certain person,
yeah. A certain person. If you listen very carefully, you may hear that certain person. No.
I said yes. I knew they were great artists and deserved to be heard.
There you are. Here is Herb Alpert back at A&M, where he's minding his successful record store.
Jack brought me the tapes, and after about three bars, I knew that I'd like them to record for A&M Records. Well, so far, they have two gold singles and one gold album. And let's face it, they've only just begun.
Herb Alpert and Jack Doherty, thank you for setting the course for Carpenter's Rise to Stardom. Now, we've been saving the two most important people in your lives till now, your mom and dad, Mr. and Mrs. Harold Carpenter. Yeah, mom and dad.
That you never...
No.
Go ahead, sit.
I tell you, Mother, you really started something, you and Papa Carpenter around here.
You were surprised to hear that introduction, that song that we introduced us. Did you recognize it?
Yeah.
You did? I don't know. What was it then, Rich?
Well, I'm all mixed
Kathy, up. What a chassis.
Oh,
the
no.
The best song you ever wrote. Start,
he was 12 years old when he wrote it. Kathy,
old.
What a chassis.
But you never expected to hear an elf play
expected.
That.
Speaking of chassis, Richard inherited a great love of cars from me, especially new ones. he's very even fussier than I am about how they look and run.
Right? Yeah, we got a new television star here, I think. Yeah. How about that? And I understand that Richard and Karen have just bought you a new home.
Yes, and they have a lovely two-story home, and I'm having trouble filling it with furniture right now, but Karen's helping with all the stuffed animals, and Richard with his music, and yeah. Karen's glove.
Here. Oh, your baseball glove, yeah, and the ball. You gotta have that all the time. Thank you very much, Mr. and Ms. Carpenter. We'll play a little cat.
We wrote Close to You about 6 years ago. I know it takes a while for a song to click, but 6 years, well, I actually wrote the song and asked Herb Alpert about recording it. Herb didn't really feel right singing the lyrics. Why do stars fall down from the sky every time you walk by? As fate would have it, Karen Carpenter finally sang those words. Her voice and Richard's musical genius made the song happen. I'd like to be with you all tonight, but schedule has me. Well, off to the tennis court now, hitting a few tennis balls, going to New York tonight, and then Lake Tahoe tomorrow. Carpenters are really helping close the musical generation gap while filling the airwaves with very good music. Believe me, Ralph, these kids have just begun.
Last Christmas, you turned out your next hit record, A Christmas Song.
Merry Christmas, darling. We're apart. That's
I wrote that song when I was 19 years old.
Your choir director from Long Beach State College, Mr. Frank Pooler. Well, you were 19, Frank, when you wrote Merry Christmas, Darling?
Yes, and I didn't think anyone would ever hear it beyond my immediate circle of friends. When Richard saw the song, he didn't care too much for the tune, but the words turned him on a bit. And so he recorded Merry Christmas, Darling.
That's a different tune, you better, because... That's my tune and his lyrics.
Yes, yeah, right.
If you wonder
right.
why we put it out and I didn't like it, I love it now. No.
Frank's words. Yeah. All right. But they didn't tell you, did they, that they were going to play for you?
No, it was a surprise to me when Richard invited me up to the A&M studios to hear kind of a premiere taping of it. And I tell you, it was one of the most moving experiences of my life. I've had some interesting times with the Carpenters over the years, but I'll never forget that experience as long as I live.
Thank you, Frank Miller, very much. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yes, and I want to thank you, Richard and Karen, for giving the Cal State Long Beach Choir an $8,000 benefit concert.
which will enable us to attend the Kansas City, Missouri National Choral Directors Convention.
And here to tell us about that concert are Pam Gibbons and Lee Vail. I understand that you originated the idea to raise the money to take the choir to Kansas City, is that right?
Yes, I did, and Karen and Richard willingly agreed to help us.
And it was a sellout, too.
Yeah.
And it packed the joint to capacity, over $8,000 worth. And in fact, when the bleachers were packed, the people were sitting shoulder to shoulder on the floor, really pounded in there.
They couldn't move once they got in.
That's great.
On behalf of the a cappella choir of Cal State Long Beach, we'd like to thank you and Richard for all your time and work and effort that you put in making that concert a success.
Oh, it's our pleasure.
Thank you.
Really.
Thank you.
Thank you, Pam Gibbons and Lee Vail. In honor of your appearance on This Is Your Life, Marshall Jewelers at Fifth Avenue, New York, has designed for Karen this gold charm bracelet, each charm depicting a very special event
beautiful.
In your life, and This Is Your Life handcuffs
beautiful.
For you over there, buddy.
Thank
Richard.
Thank you.
Incidentally, your friends have been staying at the Hollywood Roosevelt Hotel, where immediately after the show, there'll be a party in your honor. Now, with all the havoc in our world today, it's been encouraging to experience the story of two enthusiastic, ambitious, and talented young people. We've said you've only just begun.
Thank you very, very much.
For sure. Thank you very much, Karen
Thank you.
And Richard Carpenter. May the next part of your lives be as rewarding as the beginning of your This Is Your Life.
Thank you.
Good night.
Thank you.
All the travel arrangements for This Is Your Life were made by TWA. TWA 747, the ultimate in comfort and elegance. Wide aisles, oversized seats, finest in-flight dining, and your choice of movies. Somehow you feel more important on TWA.